Hello, I'm Joanna Pena Bickley. I'm the head of human effects research and design for Alexa devices at Amazon. I'm a design fellow in the Global Design Corps and a founder of an inclusive learning company called designedbyus.org and the host of the designedby.show podcast. I hope you'll give us a listen. More importantly than all of those titles, I'm dyslexic. I'm a dyslexic inventor, a story seller, a biohacker, a partner, and a mother, and a cognitive equality activist. I've spent 25 plus years unlocking my Mavrik. Mavrik is the Hebrew word for ingenuity, to build inventions that matter for the world. Today, I'm going to take you on a journey through our innovation history, because if we are to reinvent a neurodiverse future, we must face and learn from our past in order to embed our dyslexic Mavrik into a well-designed destiny. Let's begin in the pre-industrial civilization. Back to the pre-industrial society where people used multisensory learning to not only obtain new skills, but measure one's intelligence. People learned through observation and auditory instructive learning experiences. Today, we'd call that an apprenticeship. From the hunters and gatherers that taught their young to the painters, the masons, the electricians. These were the builders of our society, and they were all taught through apprentice learning models of teaching. In this model, learners observed distinguished professionals and had hands-on learning. Today at MIT, that's called action learning. And it wasn't just the trades. It was doctors and dentists and scientists and lawyers who all observed procedures, experiments, and practices in order to establish their patterns of practice. During this time, our society defined intelligence by one's ability to use multisensory hands-on learning experiences. So that brings me to an important question. When did this change? When did we cease using apprentice-based learning to define intelligence as a society? It's an important question that I've pondered for years. And as a student of history and industrial revolutions, I was able to uncover that during the first industrial revolution, a lot changed. The first industrial revolution was brought upon by a number of innovations, one of which was the steam-powered printer, which was invented by Frederick Koenig. Frederick Koenig invented the steam-powered press and made the distribution of information easy and cheap. This innovation gave way to print media, newspapers, periodicals, and books. It was a general-purpose technology that drove an economy of epic proportions. The steam-powered printer embedded text into a format that could be scaled across the globe. But by embedding that text, the world quickly began benchmarking intelligence by whether or not a person could learn by reading text off paper. During this inflection point in history, during the last global enlightenment, while we were embedding text onto paper, which was the technology of its day, we locked the door to 20% of the global population whose brains are hardwired to an apprentice or kinesthetic models of learning. Really important to think about this. 20% of the world is disenfranchised because their brains are hardwired to a different type of learning. And that brings me to the dawn of dyslexia. Just as we began embedding text onto paper and the industrial revolution began winding into a second wave, after we fundamentally shift the measure for intelligence to reading text, Doctors across the world begin witnessing a rise in the number of people struggling to read text. Rudolf Berlin, a German ophthalmologist and professor in Stuttgart, noted that in the course of his practice, he observed the difficulties faced by some of his adult and child patients in reading printed words. Rudolf Berlin coined the term dyslexic to describe their condition. He could find no problem with their vision. He speculated, therefore, that their difficulties must be caused by some physical change in the brain. Even if the nature of this eluded him, here's how he described it when treating a child. A boy, age 10, was brought to me by his father on January 8, 1900, to obtain the reason why the boy's great difficulty in learning to read. The boy had been at school for 3 years and had gotten on well in every subject except reading. He was apparently a bright young man. In every aspect, he was an intelligent boy. It was soon evident, however, on careful examination, that the difficulty in learning to read was due not to any lowering of visual acuity, but to some congenital deficiency in the visual memory of words. From about 1877 to 1973, let's be clear, that's a long span, the research of dyslexia expanded and contracted, and then it drifted from Germany to the United Kingdom to the United States. And given in that time, we were shifting towards theories of cognitive development. During that time, a series of seminal texts on dyslexia emerged. In 1970, McDonald Critchley published one of those texts. His sympathetic account, The Dyslexic Child, identified developmental dyslexia as an issue requiring urgent official attention. You see, all of our brains have an outer layer called the cortex. And across the cortex, we have components called mini columns that serve as telephone poles. What strings the mini columns together are units called axons. People with autism or on the autism spectrum have axon links that are finite and short, resulting in their superpowers to do highly specific tasks. Alternatively, dyslexics like us have mini columns that are spaced far apart, and our axon links are significantly longer. This leads to significant advantage in science, technology, entrepreneurialism, the arts, math, and design, STEAMed, as I call it. We have extraordinary skills in transforming complexity into radically simple inventions, and we are able to build and blend narratives into a tapestry of innovations that are not just seen, they're felt. Our long axons make phonetic decoding incredibly hard. Phonetic decoding is a tough word even for me to read, but phonetic decoding allows a person to identify unfamiliar words. It's our ability to look at text, translate those squiggly lines of text into sound in our minds, and string those sounds together to compose a word. For dyslexics with long axons, it takes 5 times longer than those with average links between their mini columns. For 3 industrial revolutions and 4 generations, dyslexics like me have had their world change overnight, right about the tender age of 5, when we note and realize that compared to our peers who are reading texts effortlessly, we are struggling with day 1, day 2, and even day 3 of reading text. And because our society's benchmark for intelligence is tied to the ability to read text, we are quickly labeled by peers, categorized by educators, and in many cases, discarded as dim-witted, which could not be further from the science or the truth. We have brilliant brains. But there is a high cost to disenfranchising dyslexics. 1 in 5 people are dyslexic. Dyslexic make up 35% of entrepreneurs, 40% of self-made millionaires, and 1 out of every 2 rocket scientists at NASA is dyslexic. Those are impressive stats, but they have to be set side by side with the 33% of high school dropouts who are dyslexic, the 50% of adolescents in drug and alcohol recovery who are dyslexic, and the 70% of adjudicated delinquents who have dyslexia. Today, we have an incredible, young, intelligent pool of humans behind bars because of the impacts of their dyslexic shame. And I am personally here today to tell you that this isn't some far-off story for me. It's personal. I've personally had to struggle with and in between the delta of these outcomes. And there's a reason for that. In the book, The Science of Shame, Dr. Gerald Fishkin says, "The shame is the ghost in the machine of the human mind. That shame that comes from our inability to read text is scientifically comparable to shame that people experience after having survived incest. For some people with dyslexia, their shame leads to an insidious ingress into the conscious thought that inflicts havoc on a person's self-worth and behavior. Shame is the ultimate negative reinforcer that can manifest and make you say and do things to ensure that you feel valued by your peers and by society. I know the impacts of this shame. I've experienced it firsthand. And while our society was just awakening to a dyslexic plight, I was born. I'm the daughter of a fabulously talented designer and entrepreneur in a metamorphic city called San Antonio. San Antonio is located in the state of Texas, and is only 3 hours from the border. This creative ground was the stage for my indigenous Mexican, Spanish, Texan, and American becoming. My early education experience happened amidst the tumultuous 70s and prosperous 80s. I went to Agudas Achim for preschool, and I went to Solomon Schechter Jewish Day School for elementary school. My days in school were filled with music, language, and meditative prayer. My afternoons after school were filled with love for my great-grandmother Aurora, who only spoke Spanish. My first language that I tuned my ears and my brains to were Spanish and Hebrew. And these languages of love were dripping with symbols and symbolism. They were not just a way for me to communicate. They offered me the earliest methods of learning and artistic expression. You see, reading Hebrew came easy to me. Hebrew letters are symbols that make up sentences and sounds. They're almost pictorial, almost logographic. These beautiful symbols travel my axons faster than English text. Developing an understanding and mastery of the English text and language was hard for me then and remains hard for me now. And I have to tell you that as someone who runs research, one of the things before coming to this talk today, I began to research why it was that Hebrew was easier for me. And what I found is that there is so little research on symbolic and logographic systems like Hebrew and Chinese, but somehow there is potentially a correlation to those texts and how dyslexics get along. That to me is a call to action because, as many of you know, I am a hacker, a biohacker, and I am a hacker of text interfaces. For as long as I can remember, I've been a biohacker on a mission to hacking text interfaces in pursuit of a kinesthetic learning experience. I have hacked text interfaces with multi-sensory inventions like read-alongs and read-alouds, audiobooks, and pictorial depictions of stories. Even my own note taking is supplemented with drawings of my interpretations of texts. And let's be clear, there are some days when I have to phonetically write things out because my memory and recall of how to spell the word isn't really connected. Let's be clear, my imagination was fueled by decoded tales from the Brothers Grimm, comic books, and science fiction. And this fueled my insatiable desire to learn and invent things that made the world better. And it was often a result of my desperate desire to overcome the shame of not being able to read as fast as my peers. My hacks came in the form of multisensory inventions I used to augment my cognitive experience with assisted technologies. I could not read English text until the third grade, and the restrictive nature of the educational system in Texas made for a lousy academic experience. It was at that time that I was labeled learning disabled in public school. My maverick, I want to come back to this word maverick, brilliance, right? It is embedded within my brain. It's my axons that are just longer than most people's, and so are yours. The word maverick is Hebrew for brilliant or ingenuity. And that dyslexic maverick made for a latchkey kid experience that were filled with daydreams and inventions and friends and failed experiments and neighborhood-wide entrepreneurial experiences, from lemonade stands to robotic laundry folders to magic shoes. This and my life was, there was never a moment of boredom, I can promise you that. Our garage and our driveway was my studio, an inventor's laboratory that resulted in a bevy of broken or reinvented appliances that I sold to neighbors or anyone who wanted to fund my next magic carpet, super shoes, or even robotic lawnmower. And while that seems like a storied existence, you don't have the whole picture until you understand the juxtaposition against the environment of my days at school. They were fraught with challenges to advance. I repeated grades. I was sent to expensive tutors, and I was labeled learning disabled without a complete diagnosis of which learning disability I had. In the 80s, kids like me were referred to as lazy, careless, underachieving. That label came with a lot of stigma. It wasn't until my middle school years when an English teacher, Miss Sweatman, realized that I learned, thought, and solved problems differently. You see, her dedication to the craft of teaching all people connected me to a deeper understanding and desire to understand and hack my neurodiverse mind. Once I finally graduated from high school, and I mean finally graduated from high school, I found my mojo. I taught myself to code and accelerated on a journey of inventing new human interfaces and experiences that made taking in information more immersive, more interactive, and multisensory. From, you know, this hacking life of mine started with inventing one of the first streaming video players, hacking news for ABC, or designing the first banking applications on the Apple Watch, or reinventing the cognitive or the connected car with AI for General Motors, or launching a network of cognitive experience design studios for IBM, or even today, starting the human effects labs and inventing new ambient intelligent Alexa devices. I stand before you today as a tenacious biohacker whose dyslexia has proven to help businesses and governments deliver results. My journey, like many of you, has been long, and it has had lots of ups and downs, requiring me to overcome shame, ableist barriers of credentialism, and low expectations, and an education system that is still using the old technology of embedded texts as a primary teaching tool. like 20% of the global population, dyslexia is my superpower. It provides me with extra sensory abilities to see laterally across industries and complex problems, to connect disparate threads and dots, and generate narratives that inspire action. My dyslexia has made me a fantastically talented inventor, designer, engineer, and neurodiverse crusader pursuing cognitive equality for 100% of humanity. I know that the great global reset and this industrial revolution, the fourth one, has been accelerated by automation. And this pandemic has revealed a compromised systems across the globe that no longer serve us, but actually disenfranchise more of us and disenfranchise more than dyslexics. You see, it's doing more harm than good. And that brings me to a really important place. It's actually a place of learning. It's actually a place of reset. Thanks to natural language processing, computers can now read and translate text into audio, resulting in yet another societal shift in the very definition of intelligence, which is shifting towards those of us who have skills that cannot be replaced or automated by machine learning models. You see, there's a war for talent right now. There's at least a million people with Mavrik sitting on the sidelines or behind bars. The global education system was ripe for disruption prior to the full collapse during this pandemic. The education system is quickly proving to be beyond repair, and no amount of unrequited nostalgia will help the next generation. You see, I'm a mom, and I know that my dyslexia was passed through generations of that's how we learn. It was passed from my mom to me, and I have passed it on to my children. So this fight is personal. You have to understand that we must not simply seek to transform or fix the existing system. We must reimagine it, retool it, and reinvent it with new mechanisms for funding lifelong education and STEAMed knowledge, and immersive, multi-sensory, interactive learning experiences that reach across the cosmos, not just the planet. And that brings me to a deep understanding of what we need to do next. Once we understand and harness the power we wield as lateral thinkers, we can design inventions that make teachable moments immersive and accessible to everyone around the world. We can design economic equality for women and girls. We can design the moments that extend our capabilities and the quality of our human lives. And in this way, we can design our future. You see, the flip side of any industrial revolution, particularly this one, where the tools and technology are readily available, is opportunity. It's an opportunity to take this crisis, hit reset, and think. It's an opportunity for us to think. It's an opportunity for us to design. It's an opportunity for us to change our world. So here's my challenge to you with this time. With all of this cognitive brilliance, Mavrik, and power, let's think. Let's think big. Let's think new. Let's think right now.
Let's unite and jumpstart the 21st century inclusive global enlightenment, starting by embedding knowledge into immersive action learning experiences and platforms and tools. Let's use this Mavrik that we have to unlock the knowledge for everyone, everywhere, every single day. Thank you.